Thank you for joining me for another edition of the Bob Sullivan Show. Today I have on with me from the Opinionation.com, Jamieson Welsh. How you doing today, Jamieson?
I'm good, man. Over here trying to bang out a couple more articles, got a couple more podcasts, but staying busy, my friend, staying busy. How about yourself?
I'm doing pretty well. Just living the life outside here in Omaha. Not too hot, not too cold. I'm liking the weather so far today.
That's cool.
Are you now? I was watching a little piece on ESPN. They were doing like the top 10 quarterbacks or something in the league right now.
Yep.
Now that's a usual that everybody does that. I was wondering, who do you think the best African American quarterback of all time is?
That is kind of difficult, but I'm gonna go Randall Cunningham. Warren Moon's the best. Before he came to the NFL, he had a career prior to that in the UFL. He was the best. Donovan McNabb was a close second, in my opinion. He didn't have the finish to his career that I would have liked to have seen, but it's unfortunate because he was a really good quarterback in his day. I was definitely a big fan. But at the end of the day, he didn't finish like other guys that had in their primes and whatnot. So I got to put Warren Moon up there. Donovan was really good in his prime, but he just never got over the hump. A lot of other things happened, and it was a very, very interesting situation over there in Philly. They really never liked him there, and the coaching staff, Andy Reid, as good as he was in developing quarterbacks, Andy Reid's coaching skills never fully developed into that of an elite coach. He still has issues with clock management to this day, and play calling was still suspect after being in the league 10-plus years. So a lot of that, quarterback-coach relationship and development is crucial to any relationship. Look at Belichick and Brady. They have both developed, and they're both the best in their craft for the most part. You look at a guy like Rodgers and the coach over there, they've both gotten better over time, and look at Sean Payton, Drew Brees, guys, they've gotten better and they developed as a unit, they've both gotten better. So I just think if Donovan had a better coach or if Andy Reid would have developed at a faster rate, I think he would have been better off. But at the same time, Donovan had great numbers, and it was unfortunate that he couldn't win the big one, but that's how it is. And not everybody can win the big one.
Do you think Donovan McNabb made Andy Reid, or do you think Andy Reid helped?
Combination of both, because I do think that Andy Reid having a structured offense definitely helped Donovan develop. But at the same time, Donovan, before he got hurt, before he hurt towards ACL, he was a very mobile guy, and he helped out a lot of the play calling that Andy Reid had, because there'd be times where Andy Reid would throw the ball 55 times a game, and you just can't do that with a bad O-line. So a lot of plays Donovan made because of his superior athleticism. He kept you in every game. Like, if Donovan was on the field, you knew you had a chance to win the game. And there was a point in time in his career where as long as he steps on the field, he has a chance. And that's all you can ask for. When you have an elite quarterback, that's all I want my quarterback to have, is a chance to win the game. I can live with it. I know that every Sunday or Monday, I know that my guys go out there and try to win.
Do you think Donovan would be considered for the Hall of Fame if not for his last 2 years?
I think numbers are still very Hall of Fame worthy. It's just that he's missing a ring. He's going to come up for debate. Who knows? He may get in eventually sometime down the road, but the last years don't help him. In Washington, the numbers weren't that bad. He just threw a lot of picks, but the yards and the touchdowns weren't that bad. But the whole situation got blown out. The Shanahans don't know what they're doing over there in Washington. I mean, they're still rebuilding 4 years later. So the issue is definitely more than Donovan, even though he could have played better. But that issue is – there was an issue before he got there, issue after there, after he left. So it is what it is. And last year it was just bad. From what I've heard, When he got there, he really didn't even know the playbook. And that Friday before the first game of the season, he still didn't know the plays. Like, there was, I know they had like a whole new offensive coordinator. It was a lockout shortened season, whatnot. So he didn't even know the plays. So it was just a bad fit overall. But when you got $5 million guaranteed, you got to take it.
Right. Right now, looking at the grand scheme of things in the NFL, do you think that Donovan McNabb is done? Or do you think that he has another job in him?
I don't say anyone's done because you just never know. I mean, we see quarterbacks drop all the time. And honestly, you just never know. Sometimes it takes a year or two away from the game to just realize, what you missed. And sometimes you need a breath of fresh air. Quarterbacks just drop. I mean, guys get hurt. Guys get hurt all every year. And especially solid teams that have a chance to go places. You don't want to rely on a 21-year-old or a young guy that may not have experience. If you could bring a veteran in to do a few things, then he may get a phone call. You just never know. Like, every year things happen. Every year is different. I mean, the year he got hurt back in 2002 or 2001, 2002, when he got hurt, the Eagles were thinking of bringing in thinking about bringing in Troy Aikman, who had been retired right. for 2 years. So it's just things just come up, and hey, the NFL, as we know, is your window is only open for so long. And if you have a chance to win, and if a guy can help you win, then shit, you got to make it happen because so many things happen. Look at the Saints. I mean, you would have thought their window would be open for 4 or 5 more years. With this bounty thing and all this stuff, I think they're done. I truly think they're done. I don't see them making a run anymore. It's just too much stuff to overcome. It's way too much stuff to overcome in order for them to make a run.
With the Dwight Howard, Andrew Bynum situation, I just saw on Twitter you said it was the comparison of Dwight to Bynum is like the comparison of Outback or Cheesecake Factory to Outback Steakhouse.
Right.
Can you explain that a little bit?
Yes. I have no problem. Both are really nice places to go. I mean, no disrespect to Outback Steakhouse, but Cheesecake Factory is a little bit nicer, a little bit better. Oh, yeah. I put it this way. If Bynum gets traded for Dwight, it would be a good trade because whoever gets Bynum is getting 80% on the dollar. Usually in NBA trades, you maybe get 50 cents on the dollar. Sometimes you get less. But when comparing the two, I'll just say it like this. Bynum has never been a number one option, and this is the first year he's ever stayed healthy, and he played relatively well. Dwight's been a man on the franchise. Led him to championship with his second best player being Hedo Turkoglu. In that same playoff series, he beat a Celtics team and also a LeBron James MVP-led Cavs, which during the regular season, was one of the best teams and won 67 games and all that stuff. So I just think that people don't realize how dominant Dwight is. They look at it, his offensive game isn't that great or doesn't look as pretty as Bynum does. Well, you know what? It doesn't look as pretty, but it gets it done. And at the end of the day, all I want is results. I don't care how pretty his jump hook looks. I don't care if he doesn't, finish around the basket with either hand as fluidly as Bynum does. I want to, when it comes to playoff time, when it comes to the time to go to war, I want a guy that I know I'm going to get his maximum effort at all times on both sides of the ball and won't complain no matter what's going on. But at the same time, at the end of the day, Dwight's a league shifter. Wherever he goes, he's going to shift the power to the league, just like LeBron did 2 years ago. There's only two or three guys in the league at this moment that are league shifters. Dwight's one of them. LeBron's one of them. Kevin Durant is on that page. You can call him one. Kobe, in my opinion, as great as he is, he's not a league shifter at this moment. That's only due to age. His skill set's still great, but that's just due to age. But Dwight Howard's a guy, where he goes, they're probably – if he goes to a contender, they're probably the favorites. If he goes to the Lakers, it'd be very tough to say they wouldn't be the favorites. It'd be very tough saying – because really they have the two main pieces to exploit the Heat, which is a post presence and also the point guard spot. So, you know, wherever Dwight goes, it's going to be, you know, he's going to shift the power of the league. That's just how it is. So that's why, like I said, Outback is cool, but if I have my preference, I'm going to Cheesecake Factory all day long.
Well, and plus you get better dessert at the Cheesecake Factory.
Way better dessert. Way better dessert. Not even close.
With Dwight, if he goes to the Lakers, how many championships do you think that they can win with those two? With Dwight, Kobe, Powell, Steve Nash.
Depending on health and how long they can keep that team together, because it's going to come to the point where Powell's probably going to get moved at the end of this year just due to the way the cap's going to be and the potential hit that they're going to have to take. But right now, they'll be at $90 million, and if they keep that core together, they'll be around $90 million next year as well. They're looking at like $40 million in taxes or something, either $40 or $50 million in taxes, and that's just a lot of money. But if you're winning a championship, it's worth it. If Dwight goes to the Lakers, I honestly see them winning a couple championships. If he's there for 5 years, I see them winning 2 or 3 championships. When you're big man, like, this is the thing that people understand. The NBA is now pick and roll. It's a pick and roll league. More than anything else, it's a pick and roll league. When you have a big that can show on the pick and cover and defend the basket without fouling or without disrupting your team's defense, that's a very rare skill in this game today. Only a handful of big men can do that, and Bynum's not at that level at this moment. And I don't think he'll ever be at that level just because of the way his body is made up and the way his knees are. Tyson Chandler's one of the best at it. Kevin Garnett is still one of the best pick-and-roll defenders. Dwight is up there. Joe Kim Noah. Ibaka is getting there. He's still a little raw with the angles and whatnot. But when your big man can switch on the pick and roll, slow it down, and then get back to their man, defend the basket, it's one of the rarest things you can get. So when you get a guy like that, it definitely slows down the other team.
Right. Well, if looking at the East right now, who do you think that is capable of knocking off? Do you think that the Heat or the Celtics are both capable of knocking off the Lakers, even with Dwight Howard?
If they get Dwight Howard, I don't see anyone knocking him off because they have too many dominant. They have too many dominant players at too many positions. When Pau Gasol is probably your fourth best player, you have a damn good team. If Pau Gasol is your fourth best player, that's a scare. I mean, no one else can say that. No one else has a guy. No one else's fourth guy is, you know, is that good. It's just not – I don't care. Like Miami, their fourth best guy is what, Ray Allen at 37? I'm taking Pat at 31 over Ray Allen at 37. Boston, their fourth best guy is Courtney Lee?
Yeah.
Because we got Rondo, Garnett, Pierce. I guess Courtney Lee is their fourth best player. I'm still taking Powell, even though people complain about him and whatnot. I'm still taking Powell over him. So, at the end of the day, if they get Dwight, I just don't see any team being able to control the boards and also being able to match up with those two. I mean, you have probably the two best big men in the league, all things considered in the league. You know, Powell's probably the best post player and Dwight's probably the best post defender / rebound and block shot guy in the league. So you tag those guys up, it's over.
What do you think if the Lakers wind up signing Michael Redd? If they sign him, they have Anton Jamieson and Metal World Peace off the bench, Steve Blake off the bench. What do you think of that bench? How much better does that make the Lakers?
Oh, it's definitely better. It's definitely better, but at the same time, I prefer to go a little younger at that spot. Michael Redd has had his issues with injury in the past. I prefer to get a little younger. I'd go defensive with that spot. I would get a guy like Terrence Williams. He's like 6'6", nice body. Guy plays really good defense. He's really athletic. He's still working on finding his own game. So he's a guy, if you pair with Kobe and Steve Nash, man, the sky's the limit because the talent's there. But he's never been in a really good situation. He's always been on bad teams and unstable locker rooms. If you get him in a veteran locker room with good, the sky's the limit because He's a 6'6 guy. He can guard three positions. He's a great athlete, and he can also handle the ball, which you don't find, you know, that in a whole lot of 6'6 guys. So if he can get with the Lakers, I'd be very happy. I think it would be a steal, and I think it's one of those solid moves that can propel yourself into a different level.
Who is the for the Lakers? Are they good enough right now to win the title, or do they need Dwight Howard?
Need Dwight Howard. Like I said before, I'll say it again. Dwight Howard is like a Benz. You know, he's like an S-class, S-600 Benz. Top of the line Benz, best of the best. You know, buying him, he's probably like an Audi, something like that. You know, still a nice car, very nice car, yeah. But not top of the line Benz. Like I said, I'll make even better comparison. It's like having a 350Z, you know, very nice car, but it's not like having a Benz convertible, you know, SL600 or whatever convertible dropped out. It's not like that. So there's a difference. There's definitely a difference. I understand when people watch the game, they don't understand the impact Dwight has on the game. And people only look at it offensively. Yes, his offensive game, it can still get better. And that's the thing. He's only 25. His offensive game can still develop into something way better than what it is now. But for the time being, he's gotten 22 points and 15 rebounds without having a great offensive game. And defensively, he's the best defensive center in basketball, no matter who defensive player of the year.
Who would you compare Dwight Howard to?
Patrick Ewing.
Historically.
Patrick Ewing.
Patrick Ewing, really?
Patrick Ewing. Offensively, especially when Patrick first came in the league, his offensive game wasn't that great. I mean, he still got points, but it wasn't as refined as it was later on down the road. Patrick developed a nice little 15 to 17 foot jumper. His post moves got better, you know, when he got, you know, further along the league. But defensively, that's where it reminds me of. Pat was the backline of that defense, man. Especially when Riley got there, he was backline. I mean, 9 times out of 10, he was deterring shots and making it hectic. Forgot to finish around the hoop, less of like a high flyer like Michael Jordan or Scottie Pippen. And even most of those times, he blocked them. It's just the few times that they got over him were highlights. But for the most times, he blocked their shot, you know? So, no, Patrick Ewing, I definitely see a lot of Patrick Ewing in Dwight. Dwight's not there offensively yet, but at the same time, it took Patrick a few years to come along. Patrick coming from Georgetown wasn't known as a great offensive center. You know, he was, you know how the Georgetown men are mostly defensive oriented, and then the offense comes along later, just like Alonzo Mourning and also Dikembe Mutombo. So definitely he reminds me of Patrick Ewing.
Does he remind? He reminds me a little bit of David Robinson.
Yeah, but see,
Robinson had an outside shot though, and he was a better scorer early on.
Well, David Robinson scored like 73 points in a game or 71 or something like that. So David was a better scorer from the get-go, really good on defense, but he was more of a scorer, that's why I don't compare him to that much. And, you know, even though Pat could get you 40 or 50 any given night, he could take over a game. His mostly would get you like 20-25. That's where I see Dwight, 20-25 with 13 to 15 boards, 2-3 blocks a game, and controlling the game. Controlling the game on both sides, and really on the defensive end. Just control the game and, playing within the team concept of defense, because those early 90s Knicks teams were really good. They just ran to the wrong team. Those teams were really, really good. You had Mace and Oakley, Starks, Greg Anthony, Hubert Davis. You had a lot of defensive-minded players. So defensively, it was very hard to score on those guys. They just ran to the wrong guy at the wrong time, which is Michael Jeffrey Jordan, who's the best ever played.
With this Olympic team, I've been saying if this team had Derrick Rose, Bynum, and Dwight Howard, and I guess you can throw Blake Griffin in there. Either Blake Griffin or Kevin Love, leave one of those two on, take the other one off.
Mm-hmm.
And you bring this team up against the Dream Team, I think that this team could win with those three. And you take off James Harden, maybe a Russell Westbrook, maybe a and Anthony Davis. What do you think of
versus
that?
Versus the 92 team?
Yeah.
All right. I'm getting kind of tired of this whole thing because it all started with, you know, Kobe making those comments. And first of all, what are you supposed to say? People say, oh, no, we're going to get killed? Like, no, that's not in his DNA. And if he really thinks they can beat him, hell, God bless him. I think they match up very well with that 92 team with the players at that time. Because people don't realize Stockton was hurt most of those Olympics. He went into the Olympics with a broken foot, I believe, or coming back off a broken foot. And Magic, you know, was coming back off a year not playing. So already the U.S. has a good spot, you know, a pretty good advantage at the point. Now the two guard situation is a little bit different because you have Michael Jordan in his prime. You know, you have Clyde Drexler in his prime, going against Kobe a little bit out of his prime. And you got guys, let's say Dwayne Wade, who's just now leaving his prime. You have him healthy. I would gravitate towards the 9-2 squad, but it's not a landslide. It's not a landslide. It's, you know, it's not like, you know, it's somewhat close. And then, you got 3 spot. You got LeBron and you got Durant going against Scottie Pippen and Chris Mullin and all those guys. I'll take my chance, but, you know, Durant, LeBron. That's how it is. Now, where the bad thing happens is at the 4 or 5 spots is where, you know, that's where the dream team would make it. You know, that's where they would make their parts at. But at the same time, I think Kobe's right. If they can win a game, if they play a series, yeah, they would get a game or two, but they're not beating them in a series. And the 92 team is better. But I do believe that, you know, if the team is full squad, yeah, I definitely think they can get a game from the 92 squad. I mean, of course, we'll never know. But at the same time, we got to start eliminating the nostalgia of everything. We got to stop saying, you know, oh, well, this person's the best, blah, blah, blah. Yes, we know Michael Jordan's the best. But you know what? Hey, anything is possible, and no one's untouchable. Back then, the teams they were playing against, the teams were taking pictures of the guys. They weren't even pros. Like, the guys that they're playing against, you know, people that didn't even really play basketball. Now it's way different. That's why when Team USA wins by 6, oh, well, the Dream Team would have never just won by 6. Well, the Dream Team didn't play against a team with 7 pros on it. They played against a team taking pictures and guys trying to get autographs during timeout. So people just need to realize and try to get all the facts where they make comments because it's just ridiculous. It's very uneducated and it's unfair, and people got to leave the past alone.
Well, I don't have a – I mean, the only reason I would actually take right now, I would take 08 over this team. And I just think down low that they're more physical.
Yeah, right. No, I agree. I like the 08 team. I slightly like the 08 team better than this team just because you have Kobe in his prime. You had LeBron in his prime. You had Dwayne Wade in his prime. You had Dwight in his prime. You had Chris Paul and Darren Williams both in their primes. In 08, I thought Kevin Durant should have been on the team in one way, shape, or form. I didn't think Tayshaun Prince needed to be on the team, but I really thought that Kevin Durant should have been on the team. He said he was that good then. I remember watching him at practice back in 07 for the U.S. team, and I'm like, man, wow, this guy's one of the best players on the court. And this is at the time where Kobe was still really, really, really good and athletic, and LeBron was entering his own as well. So I really thought Durant should have been on the team, but when it comes to USA, there's a lot of politics involved. A lot of stuff people don't realize what goes on. It's the reason why James Harden's on the team. It's the reason why. So politics plays part. You know, personally, I thought Rudy Gay should have made the team. They needed more size. But when you got a guy like Kevin Durant, who's this good, and his best buddy, Russell Westbrook's on the team too, and James Harden's trying out, they're not going to not have James Harden on the team. That's just not going to happen. So
who on this team do you think is a future Hall of Famer?
Kobe, LeBron, Durant, Chris Paul, Darren Williams. Let's see, who else? If Westbrook keeps on playing, he'll be in there because his stats are – what he can do, what he's capable of doing is just ridiculous. Let's see, who else is on the team? Kevin Love. I mean, the guy's getting 20 and 20 every night. I mean, he's definitely going to be in there if he keeps on.
Carmelo?
Carmel's going to be in there. He has great numbers. I mean, most of the teams going to be in the Hall of Fame. I would say probably Harden is the only guy at the moment I can think of that probably won't be there. And we know what's going to happen with Anthony Davis. We don't know yet, so we can't, you know, we don't know. But right now, him and Harden are the only two guys I can say that are on the outside looking in at this moment. And that could very well change. Let's see. Iguodala's probably not going to make it, but you never know what's going to happen. You know, he's so young, and he can go. If he gets to a contender, that's one guy. If Andre Iguodala ever gets to a contender where he can just do what he's really good at, man, he's another guy that can not shift power of the league, but he can make a contender. He can put a contender over the top. I'll put it that way.
Do you think 03 draft is the best draft ever?
Nope. I'm going to go with the 96 draft and also the 84 draft. The 03 draft is good. It's very good. But we will see. We got to see because the 96 draft still has a lot of guys playing in it, especially in that first round. Has a lot of guys playing it, still playing at a productively high level. You know, 03 draft, outside of LeBron, D-Wade, Carmelo, and Bosch, we will see where guys are at in a few years. Because a few guys are already falling off. Chris came in that draft, I believe.
Yep.
If I'm not mistaken. Kurt Howard was in that draft as well.
So Marquise Daniels.
Right. So we'll see, but for my money, I'm going 84 and 96. And then I'm going to go with, 84, 96, and then 03.
Who do you think? Do you think Samaki Walker had the best attire for any draft class?
He's in the top five because his attire, Carmelo, Chuck, Jalen Rose, and then LeBron with the all-white suit was really nice. But I also like Joakim Noah's look because he started that whole professor with the bow tie and all that stuff. He had a little unique look, so I like his look as well.
If you're looking at a little bit of NFL here, a little bit more of an NFL.
Uh-huh.
Going into training camps, I mean, we don't have any injuries yet. We don't have any really know-how of what's going to happen. The future is unpredictable. But who right now are you not a fan of? Like that? Are you a fan of the? Are you more so a fan of the Cowboys or the Eagles as far as?
Oh, I'm an Eagles. I'm an Eagles fan. I'm an Eagles fan. I'm very optimistic, but at the same time, I'm not too over-optimistic because I've seen everything happen. So I try not to get too excited until, you know, the chips are down. When it comes down to it, I mean, you know, I'm tired of the whole Tebow to the Jets thing because, to me, that's a non-issue. Tebow's probably the worst quarterback in the league that has started. Last year was a lot of fluky shit happened to get that team to where they were at. I mean, if all that lucky shit doesn't happen, they're a 4-12 team or a 5-11 team. You know, a lot of lucky stuff and weird breaks here and there just happened and it went in their favor, but the truth came out in the division round when they got killed by the Patriots. You know, so I'm just tired of the whole Tebow thing. I mean, he's not, or if Mark Sanchez plays well, they get his guy extension. If he plays well, Tebow's not seeing the field. You know, and I think Mark Sanchez can play well if they play to his strengths. You can't have an offensive coordinator go there and say, hey, we're not going to let you throw the ball deep, but then get mad at them when they don't win. You know, you can't do that. You got to, if you're going to trust them, trust him. If not, get somebody else in there who's hand the ball off. But I think I'm not a huge Mark Sanchez fan, but I do think he could be effective in the right situation. I don't think Tebow's going to do anything. If you let Tebow be the quarterback of the Jets, then you might as well fire Rex and get rid of Sanchez right now. Because he's the guy that's going to have your team 4-12, and it's going to be a mess in New York. So they better hope Sanchez pans out, because if he doesn't, there's going to be trouble. There's no need to trade Tebow. There's no need at all. That's not the guy you want bringing in quarterback competition. They're better off signing Jason Campbell or something like that. There's no need to bring in Tebow. That was the worst mistake they ever made.
Is there more, like, the Jets fan base and the Jets organization piss me off more than any other fan base?
They're up there.
Who's your most hated
Well, yeah, I'm man. West Coast. A few that are cool, but for the most part, most of them are hella annoying, and they're very snobbish and douchebags for the most part. You know, especially on the West Coast, man. You think, talking to Charger fans, you think they have a few rings by now. They talk like they got rings, but they don't have any rings. They take on the persona of their GM, who no one likes, and no sports agent likes. I think AJ Smith is their GM, that makes all the decisions for that team. You know, so me personally, it has to be the Chargers. I'm tired of them every year. You got Charger fans talking real reckless out here. But at the end of the day, they're going 8-8, 9-7, and they're at home at Super Bowl time like everybody else.
Where do you think the – do you think the Eagles with Vic are even a Super Bowl contender? Or do you think that that's – do you think Vic's a Super Bowl caliber quarterback?
Yeah, if he's healthy, he's definitely, he's healthy and he stays healthy and plays right. Yeah, definitely. But at the same time, that's a big question. I mean, he's only played one full season, being healthy one full season. So it's just the numbers aren't on his side and the way he plays the game. And just honestly, for a quarterback, he's just not that big or strong. For a quarterback, it's just, you want a guy that can take a little pounding here and there. He's a guy, he weighs less than 200 pounds, takes a lot of hits because the offensive line is not good and the pocket's constantly moving. So it's not like you're protecting, like a Peyton Manning or a Tom Brady or a Drew Brees. Your pocket's constantly moving because you have a quarterback that's constantly moving. So when that happens, there's going to be blown assignments. There's going to be blitzes that don't get picked up. And if that happens, you're one hit away from being out 4 to 6 weeks because the guy is getting hit. And as strong as other quarterbacks around the league. So, if Vic can stay healthy, yeah, they can make a run. But at the same time, I think karma is going to bite them in the butt again because they're talking about being a dynasty and they made the playoffs and they haven't made a Super Bowl run. So whenever you start talking like that without having the hardware to back it up, it's not a good thing.
Who do you think is going to move to L.A.?
The Jacksonville Jaguars.
Really?
Eventually, well, you know what? I take that back. If they don't, well, I think they have a new lease or something like that, so it's not going to be them. San Diego Chargers will be the L.A. Chargers in 2 years.
Do you think the Raiders will ever move back?
No, there's way too much bad blood between the Raiders organization and the L.A. Way too much bad blood, way too many court battles. It's not going to happen. Even when Al Davis gone, it's not going to happen. San Diego's been looking for a new stadium. Baseball team got a new stadium, not enough money to get a football stadium down there. They have to bring up a team in L.A. They have to. Got to have a decent team with a recognizable star, which Philip Rivers is, even though he's not as good as people think he is or he thinks he is, but he's still a pretty good player. He's definitely a recognizable name. I see the Chargers moving up to L.A. in 2 to 3 years. The stadium's going to be built up by 2015, and once the stadium's built up by then, whoever goes there is going to gain an extra $100 million in their teamwork just by being in Los Angeles. So I expect it to be the San Diego Chargers, which would be the LA Chargers, which would be pretty cool.
Do you think football can work in LA?
Oh yeah, definitely. If you have a solid team, it definitely can work. The problem with the Raiders, the reason why they didn't work is because they played the Coliseum where it's 110,000 seats. So of course you're not going to sell out. It's damn near impossible to sell a 110-seat stadium. It's just not going to happen. So you're never on TV. Your fans really can't see you. All that good stuff. I think if you put a good team in downtown LA, especially with football not being there the last 20 years almost, I think you have a really good chance that football does very well in Los Angeles.
Who would you most like to see win a Super Bowl this year? Romo, Vic, is there a quarterback out there that you think deserves a ring that hasn't gotten one yet?
You know what? Deserve has nothing to do with it, my friend. Because if that's the case, Jim Kelly would have got one. Donovan would have got one. A bunch of other guys would have got one. Deserve has nothing to do with it. You don't deserve it. You just got to go get it. Plain and simple. You got to go get it. Personally, I like to see somebody random get a Super Bowl ring. I would love to see a guy like Ryan Fitzpatrick get a Super Bowl ring, just because I think it'd be great for football. But honestly, I think the Packers, Giants, you know, teams like that, I see any of those teams like that. Or even though, you know what, I see Matt Schwab is healthy getting a ring. With that defense and that type of team they have, I see them getting a ring. I really can. But, you know what, like, you know, guys like Vic and Romo and those guys, you know what, go out there and play. You know, go out there and play. Forget all the BS. Go out there and play and let your play do the talking. It's too many interviews. I'm tired of seeing the interviews. I'm tired of seeing all this stuff. Just go play, man. I'm tired of seeing the sad interviews every year. You know, Tony Romo giving the same sad ass answers every year. You know, Vic giving the same sad ass answers and all the excuses. Just go play. You have the talent. You have the ability. Stay healthy and go play. You deserve it. Nothing to do with it. You know, good quote from The Wire, the sitcom The Wire, one of the best shows ever. Snoop said to one of the guys, deserve has nothing to do with it. Don't matter. You know, just go, you gotta go out and do what you gotta do.
Where do you see the Raiders finishing this year? I'm a huge Giants fan, but I will walk over coals for Al Davis. I love Al. I have always loved Al Davis. Always respected the guy. But and I was sad to see him pass before they could get another Super Bowl for the game.
Mm-hmm.
But where do you see the Raiders going this year?
If Darren McFadden stays healthy and he plays up to his capabilities, which he usually has, you know, while being healthy, I see the Raiders in that division. He's one of the few guys in the league that he can dominate a game when healthy and when he's getting his touches. He's one of the few guys that, you know, he can make. He's a home run hitter. He's a guy that you give him the rock, he can take it to the house any given time, no matter how you give it to him, whether it's on the screen, on a counter play, whatever. Whenever you have a guy like that that can dominate a game, you're always able to swing games. And in a division like that, you know, where it's very wide open, I can see him single-handedly taking over two or three games. You know, that might be a question. And if Carson Palmer is just average or slightly above average, I see the Raiders winning 9 or 10 games in the division. But their defense isn't that good. It's really average, but having a guy like McFadden, if he stays healthy, he's one of the ultimate weapons in the league. That outside of Adrian Peterson and Arian Foster, McFadden, if healthy, is my other best back in the league.
Do you think the Broncos are a year away with Peyton?
I'm not a big believer in the Broncos. I need to see a lot more. I need to see Peyton in action before, you know, we go anywhere. I'm kind of tired of seeing, you know, I'm kind of tired of hearing about all this stuff. You know, we have four neck surgeries, man. Football is not something you should be on. That should be on your plans. You know, we have four neck surgeries. You need to be thinking about life. I don't care what kind of fusion surgeries they are, whatnot. And you're away from the game for a year. That's also a tough thing. You know, that's another thing people aren't really talking about. But it's very difficult for somebody to not play football 1 year and come back and expect them to win 12 games. That's very unfair. And also, a lot of people are expecting Peyton Manning from 04 to 08, like he's not going to miss a beat. Well, that's very tough to do because in those years he had Marvin, he had Reggie Wayne, he had Dallas Clark, Justin Dye, all those guys in their primes. You know, this Denver team doesn't have those kind of weapons. So it's going to be very interesting to see what takes place because, you know, if they don't start off as breaks. Remember, a lot of those teams start off 10-0, 12-0, 13-0. Right. If they start off 3-3 and 4-5, if it's not great, there's going to be a lot of pressure on Peyton because he's used to getting off to great starts, making a lot of stuff happen. You know, I just don't see that with this Denver team. Plus, it's a learning process. I mean, Peyton was in Indy for 15 years. Or like 14 years, or however long it was, he was there for a very long time, so he was a system. Now he's trying to acclimate everything and try to learn new receivers, learn new playbooks. It's going to be very difficult for him, and it's unfair to have crazy expectations of a guy that didn't play football last year.
Who is somebody, like, of the two, after Luck and RG3, who do you like having a better year? Brandon Weeden? Is it Tannehill? Or do you think those guys will both be busts?
Those are both terrible picks, in my opinion. If I choose one of those guys, I'd go with Whedon, only because he has a really good running back, and the receivers he has aren't that bad. I'm not sure whoever else. Oh, you know what? If Peyton goes down and the backup, Brock Osweiler, I believe the guy's name is, if he has to play, I think he'll be okay. I think he can be decent. He can throw the Brock a lot. Accuracy's not a strong suit, but if he's working with Peyton, he'll be all right. He's a big guy. He can take a hit. So I think if he has to come in, I think he'll be okay. But, you know, out of the rookie quarterbacks, outside of the top two, I wouldn't want to see anyone in action. I'll put it that way.
All right. Jamming with Jamieson, the second ever edition. What do you got for us this week, Jamieson?
Man, you know what? I'm getting really, really, really tired of people talking about athletes. And whenever they come up with an opinion, they want to criticize what they say. But at the same time, when someone says no comment or next question, they get upset for, you know, well, why don't they answer the question? Why don't they do this? Why don't they do that? But when they do answer the question, then people set the answer. It's like an old, you know, a good friend of mine told me that if you don't get mad at what you may find if you go snooping. You know, if you go looking for dirt, don't be mad if you come back looking for you. You know what I mean? It's like how females go looking at dudes' phones and get mad at what they see, knowing damn well you know you had an idea of what might be in that phone, but you still went and looked anyway. You can't be mad at anyone but yourself. You know, so I'm getting really tired of people saying, oh, well, that's a crazy comment, or, you know, this is that, this is this. You know what? I don't mind, for the most part, I don't mind athletes speaking their mind, because at the end of the day, there's a freedom, there's a free country, and they're able to say whatever they want to say. You know, if someone asks them a question, they have a right to answer it however they want to. If that's how they feel, so be it. You know, an opinion is an opinion. Opinion's not a fact. It can't be right or wrong. It's just their opinion. Like I said, the Kobe guy asked that question. What the hell is he supposed to say? Nah, we get blown out? Hell nah. If you're a basketball, it's like somebody coming up to me and you saying, oh, we can do a better podcast, or who does a better podcast than you, or such and such does better. Nah, hell nah. Like, I'm like, me, Bob, and EJ can all be better podcasts and such and such and such. That's just how it's going to be. That's just me. When I do something, I want to be the best at it, or I can see myself really good at something. I'm not gonna allow anyone else to try to take my, you know, try to take my fame, or try to, you know, say they're better than me, you know, without any proof. Nah, you know, I'm a better. That's what I like to do. So if someone asks me, a question similar to that, I'm gonna be like, hey, you know, I feel that I'm better than this. My team would do a better job. And I have no problem with athletes. I have no problem with celebs speaking the truth, because we always ask that. That's why we love Charles Barkley so much. Everyone loves Chuck because he's honest, and he's kind of crazy, but he's honest, and he tells you what you want to hear. You know, like today, he came out and said he was better than Karl Malone. He came out and said it. He said he truly believes he was better than Karl Malone. You know what? I tend to agree with Chuck for a couple reasons, but just for the fact he said that, I have a lot more respect for him, because a lot of guys, they may feel they're better than some people. Like guy Clyde Drexler, he may feel he was better than Michael Jordan. That might not be the case, but he may feel that way. You know what? If he were to say it, I wouldn't really care. I mean, I might, you know, I might send a shout out to over Twitter, but I'm not going to be like, well, there's no way he's better than Jordan. No, and, you know, so people need to get over that. You know, people need to chill and relax and enjoy the comments. Enjoy it from a fan perspective. Stop trying to overanalyze things. Everybody's trying to act like they're on ESPN. Everybody's trying to act like a damn analyst. Do your job. Stay in your lane. Know your role. Stop trying to overthink everything. You know, let people know what they're going to say. Like, I'm tired. Everybody trying to, you know, go deep into the thoughts. You know, trying to go deep into something that's not there. You know, let it be. Let it be. Because at the end of the day, man, a lot of people's lives are messed up, and they always try to analyze or trying to interpret things that has nothing to do with them, has no impact on them, and it's getting out of hand.
One last thing before I let you go.
Yeah, man, what's good?
Do you know that Serena Winters from Lakers Nation?
I don't know her personally, no.
Ah, dang it.
I
was going to have you put in a good word for me.
No, Jabari's the Laker Nation guy.
Okay.
Yeah, he's a guy. Jabbar's a guy. You want to know anyone from Laker Nation? He knows all guys. I believe he writes a piece. Let me ask you a question.
Okay, go ahead.
Last podcast, we were talking about food and whatnot, and you watch a lot of sports. What do you like to watch while you're eating? What do you like to while you're watching? Watching sports on TV or online or however you watch games. Everybody watches games differently these days. I mean, I'm fortunate enough to have DirecTV, so I don't have to worry about a whole lot of different things. But how do you enjoy watching games these days?
This is during the regular season of the NFL. I will get just like a something. Do you guys have Boston Market out there?
We used to, but they kind of phased out.
Well, I like to get, during football season, I'll get like Boston Market, like their slider meal. I'll get two of their slider meals with macaroni and cheese.
Okay.
And mashed potatoes and I don't even waste my time getting their pop. I go and get like a 2 liter of Dr. Pepper from the store.
For a dollar.
Yeah, for a dollar.
Right.
And I take it easy drinking-wise during the season because come playoff time, I know that it's gonna be a shit show. I do have my drinking game for the NBA playoffs on my Twitter, but I do during the playoffs, I like to have a shots-filled drinking vodka drinking game for the NBA playoffs, and then for the NFL, I go to this place called DJ's Dugout in Omaha.
Okay.
And it has four, projection screens inside there.
Mm-hmm.
And they have the best food in Omaha, the best, setup for a bar possible. And so I'll go there, throw a few beers back, eat, self-induced coma because I've eaten so much. So that's what I'll do for the playoffs. And then for a regular season, I just eat wings with my buddies at an apartment or at my house or something like that. So, yeah, I just say it's mostly eating terribly. What's your favorite food for during a game?
Man, it all depends. You can never go wrong with a good sandwich. Whether it's a cheesesteak, a pastrami, a club sandwich, you can never go wrong with a sandwich, in my opinion. Never go wrong with a pizza. Never go wrong with wings. But me personally, if it's an important game, it depends. A couple of different things I like to do. My go-to stuff, I'm really hungry, long day. I go to Memphis Championship Barbecue out here in Vegas. I get the platter that has ribs, brisket, links, pork, everything. Comes with three sides. If I'm watching, let's say the NFC and AFC Championship games on, and I don't have any plans, I'm going to have that because it'll last me the full 6 hours. I'm not eat all of it at once. I can pick that as much as I want to, and I'm satisfied for the full 6 hours. So all is good. If it's like a basketball game, I tend to go with something like, tacos or a wing, something like that, because only 2.5-3 hours long. It's not that long, But if it's a football game, you can never go with chili. I have a good friend out here that makes the best chili, some of the best chili I ever had. So it just all depends on the event. I really don't watch baseball games through and through, but when I do watch football games at a sports book, at the Palazzo, they have this probably the best that sports book, Lugassi Stadium, the world's famous chef, Lugassi, he made the menus, so a lot of that stuff is really good. It's kind of expensive, but it's really good. It's the best nachos I've ever seen. I'll quit pick it after the show, but best nachos ever, and it'll fill you up, and it's great for football. Nachos is football food, and it's not the cheese sauce, it's actual real nachos, where you put the chips, whatever meat you have, the salsa, jalapenos, with real cheddar cheese. It's really good. It's unexplainable. It's that damn good.
Mm. Mm-hmm. We should, you know what we should do? We should do our own show on like Blog Talk Radio, discussing our food preferences, like that week's food, like what you should eat for that week in the NFL, like depending on the matchup, like if it's Philly versus Dallas on Sunday Night Football, you're eating Philly cheesesteak, wings, and like some kind of Dallas kind of
food.
Yeah, the theme food for Sunday Night Football.
One thing is, it gets kind of tough because, I mean, you only have so many things. Like, let's say Jacksonville is playing the Ravens on Monday night. What do you do? Like, what food out in Jacksonville? Like, I don't know any Jacksonville themed food. And the only thing I know in Baltimore is crab cakes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, it would be tough. Or we could just pick out, like, a matchup or something. Or
yeah, it has, like you said, a Philly-Dallas thing or a New York-Chicago thing. We have, like, a Chicago deep-dish pizza. Or we have, like, some New York, like, I don't know, a bunch of New York Italian food, something like that. I mean, New York is so known for so many different things. But something like that. Or you have, like, the San Diego Chargers playing. You know, let's say they're playing, who would they be playing? Well, let's say San Diego's playing, you could do like fish tacos. Fish tacos,
oh, yeah.
You know, like a San Diego thing. So you can do something like that. If you're playing like this, if you have like a jambalaya or like, you know, spicy chicken or something like that. So a lot of different ideas. Matter of fact, the Cooking Network, they had a little show a couple years ago where they did tailgates. And the cooking squads, what they would do is they would do like a themed, whatever their meal was, it was themed after their team. So like I know the Saints, I remember when the Saints and Vikings opened the season up a couple years ago, they had on the Food Network with Doc Gary, the guy who does Dining Drivers or Dining, whatever it's called.
Right.
He put from like, I think it was every Monday night game or every week he went to different stadiums. And you know, the two cities would match up, and they had squads. And I remember, they had like a Cajun dish with like the 3/4 Cajun dish with a Cajun appetizer, a Cajun entree, Cajun dessert. And in Minnesota, they had a Minnesota dish, so it was something similar to that, but it was really good. They had it for the full season. I remember they went to Oakland, they went to Chicago, they went to a lot of places. So, and you know, tailgate shit, that's one of the best. You get your best foods at tailgate. You know, because no one likes to eat. Honestly, no one likes to eat inside the stadium. I'd rather pay $10, everybody chip in $10, and get a bunch of food and barbecue it before we go in. Be drunk, so the only thing I have to do is to buy at the stadium is like a soda or something. I'd rather do that than, you know, pay $4 for food inside the stadium.
What's the best tailgate you've ever been to?
Oh, man, that's a good question. That's a very, very good question. I haven't been to that many tailgates because, like I said, in football, in California, we don't have a whole lot of football teams nearby, so that's where your best tailgates are. I've had a couple good tailgates at Dodger Stadium, but I have a friend. I'm going to a game hopefully this year up Oregon. The Oregon Ducks, I heard, is a really good tailgate. A friend of mine, he was raised about it. People just chipping $5. All you eat, chili, sliders, or whatever, you know, whatever they have. But it's usually like chili, like really good chili, really good sliders, like chicken, that kind of stuff. Everyone just chips in $5 and the food is unlimited, alcohol is unlimited. And they take their tailgate really seriously up there. So I'm definitely looking forward to that. Also, I gotta go to Oakland to see a game. I'm not a fan per se, but I gotta go up there and see a game for the experience. And I got to do the tailgate because I was telling there as well.
Last thing before I let you go.
Yes, sir.
You want to tell everybody about the Opinionation Network and your show?
Man, the Opinionation Network is doing really big things right now. A lot of us have shows on there. I'm not sure if I'm going to try the plan, but I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to complete it. I believe Jabari's on Monday. My show's on Tuesday. My show pop kind of current news event show with celebrities and athletes, the news that they get into outside the court mainly. We do touch on sports a little bit, but mainly it's a current event show and what's going on inside, you know, the stuff that ESPN tries to talk about, we try to get into, because there's an issue with that, since all these athletes have role models and whatnot, or since all these athletes have a lot of guys following them and people want to be them, we got to put them in check because, you know, they make a lot of bad decisions. So we got to try to monitor that and try to get people on the right track. So we're going to put people on blast on every Tuesday. Wednesday, I believe, is the NFL show. You have EJ and I think the guy's name is Paul from Pro Football Zone or something like that. Thursday is the show with Juan Stan. I believe it's going to be a baseball / sports show. Thursday, I want to say, is Mark Francois' show. I think they're talking about a lot of sports. He's going to be geared more to California sports teams. Friday, I'll be on back again. I'm talking about college football with my boy Alec out there in California doing really big things for a young guy. So yourself, I think you're a couple years older than him, but he's doing a lot of big things for himself. A lot of good things for guys 20 years old, man. Very impressive. You know, you don't see a lot of 20-year-olds have their stuff there like he does. So I'm very proud of him, and I'm looking forward to being on with him, man. He has a lot really good head on his shoulders and a lot of good stuff going on for him. On Saturday, I want to say Jabbar is back on again. I'd be mistaken. I think that might be an open date. And then Sunday is a TV going over TV shows, a lot of HBO specials like Newsroom and Weeds, all that, whatever TV sitcom is going on that people want to talk about. I want to say that. So that's also, that's the Nation Network, man. We're trying to do big things, man. Trying to do big things. Trying to be the best, small network we can be, man, and try to go places. Also. Also have a show outside of the network. It's included in the network, but it's not on the schedule. It's called Locks. We're gonna go over the NFL spreads with a few experts every week. Probably gonna have 2 or 3 guests a week, going over the spreads, going over the lines, getting guys' opinions, whatnot. It's gonna be funny. Two is not your average sports gambling show. It's definitely not that. And also for all my shows, I want to advise you now. I'm not liable for anything I or my guest say. So, what's the phrase I gave you? Discretion advised?
Yeah, viewer discretion advised.
Yeah, viewer discretion advised. So, but definitely we always have fun. Whatever show we do, it's going to be fun. It's not going to be you're just throw facts at you and you take it. Nah, you're going to get you laugh, but it's also informative. It's going to be funny. It's going to be engaging. That's what we try to do in every show we try to get across. That's pretty much about it, man. I'm on Twitter, at The Real Jamieson. If you ever want to, ask any questions or whatever, I'm there. I'm there a lot, so just hit me up. It's an honor to be on your show. I mean, I greatly appreciate it. And also, I have one special shout-out. Besides you and Jabari, Jay, and everybody, I shout-out the Carey Sisters. They were, like, the first small podcast I ever listened to a couple years back, and they were located out here in Vegas, and their podcast was very funny, very engaging. It was kind of like a sports / pop podcast, and I really enjoyed it, and they're some of the reasons I'm doing what I'm doing today, so I greatly appreciate them, and if it wasn't for them, I probably wouldn't be doing this, so gotta thank them as well.
Are they still doing it?
They don't as of right now. I keep on trying to bait them doing it, but I hope they do. I hope they get back. They're literally funny, and we'll see. We'll see. But if it wasn't for them, I wouldn't be doing this. I just got them again because they're really good people.
Well, Jamieson, I appreciate you coming on. We'll definitely do this again. Does Friday work for you?
How about Saturday?
Saturday would work. We'll do this again Saturday then.
Also, we got to give a shout-out to the Los Angeles Dodgers for stealing Hanley Ramirez for 2 hot dogs with no condiments. Got to give a shout-out to the Dodgers front office for stealing Hanley Ramirez. I appreciate that.
Yeah, I don't even know what to say anymore. The Dodgers, this could be like that Manny Ramirez trade they made a couple years ago.
I'm comparing it to the Pau Gasol trade personally, but yeah, I try to forget Manny because that whole situation kind of blew up in our faces. But I compare it to the Pau Gasol trade because you're still a very young guy in his prime. As good as Manny was, he was kind of outside of his prime. But getting Hanley at 28, you know, he still had a lot of talent left. He is his first head. And I think it would get better. You know, I think.
Well, Jamieson, I appreciate you coming on. We'll do this again Saturday. And good luck with the new show and the Opinionation Network. I'm a big fan of all you guys over there. And you guys have always been very welcoming to me on my show and been great on my show. So I appreciate you guys.
Hey, man, no problem, man. It's a, you know, it's a great, great honor to be on your show, man. I'm not going to steal Jabari's line. I know you're out there listening. You're going to listen. I'm not going to steal your line. I'm just going to say it's an honor to be on your show. I greatly appreciate it. I can't wait till next time.
All right. Sounds good, Jamieson. I appreciate it, man.
All right. Not a